stars mellowed to their tender light, which heaven to gaudy day denies. One shade the more, one ray the less, had half impaired the nameless grace which waves in every raven tress, or softly lightens o'er her face, where thoughts serenely sweet express how pure, how dear their dwelling place. And on that cheek, and o'er that brow, so soft, so calm, yet eloquent, the smiles that win, the tints that glow, but tell of days and goodness spent, a mind at peace with all below, a heart whose love is innocent.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the annual historical walk of the Clinton Grove Cemetery Association. Today, we are honoring the 140th anniversary of this establishment. You know, it's not very often that we are privileged enough to have such a very distinguished guest as the noted speech pathologist and historian, Dr. Philip Grove. The stories he's going to tell us about the people who lived in this area are more fascinating than anything you'll see on a daily soap opera, believe me. And now, here's your host, Pat DeWandler.
Today we're coming to you from Clinton Grove Cemetery, where we're on a walking tour with Dr. Phil Grove and the fifth grade students at Ojibwa Elementary School. Dr. Grove has a very refreshing approach as to how he teaches history. Let's go join Dr. Grove and the children in the mausoleum.
Good morning and welcome to Clinton Grove Cemetery. Clinton Grove Cemetery is celebrating its 145th anniversary this year here in Clinton Township. Clinton Grove Cemetery was set up under a state law of Michigan that was passed in February of 1855 that allowed local cemetery associations to organize, setting themselves up with officers, 9 trustees, and to operate in a democratic way. The cemetery here has been operated that way in the 145 years. The ownership of the cemetery is in the hands of all those whose families have lands and burial spaces here, and those who expect to be buried here at some other time. So it is probably one of the largest cemeteries still operating under the law of 1855. Now, this morning we've been entertaining, we've been talking to youngsters from one of the schools of the Chippewa Valley school system. This is an annual event that the fifth grade teachers bring their youngsters to learn something of the past and at the same time to learn some lessons that they might carry with them forward into their lives. So welcome to all of the children and all the parents who are here, and again, welcome to the teachers who have been here before. So I'm very interested in history. I think probably I grew up with history in a rather unique way. You see, I'm my own cousin. Not once, not twice, not three times, but four times. Because my great-great-great-grandparents Grow were the same ancestors for mother and father. And my great-great-great-grandfather Dimling was the same ancestor for mother and father. And Mr. Dimling's two wives themselves were cousins. So we go around the bush, and my grandmother, my mother's mother, would sit me down when I was a child, not much older than you children, and teach me my family history. And I hope sometime you'll have a chance to sit with your grandparents or great-grandparents, if you have them, and ask them about their family history, where they came from, why they came to America, if they came from another country in recent years, what they hoped to see and what their experiences were, and learn what you can from your parents, because when you're grown up, they may not be around anymore, and when you have questions then, it will be too late to ask. Now this mausoleum was built in the 1930s with an addition about 1950. And one time, with the help of our teacher over here, Mr. Cates, we figured out that there were almost 1,200 folk either entombed or interred in this building. Entombment means the casket is placed in the wall. Interment means that the ashes, the cremains of the deceased, are placed in a niche like those behind me. Over the centuries, mankind has made arrangements for the burial and the honoring of the dead, of their tribe or of their nation. In the United States, most people are buried in a cemetery. Some are placed in a mausoleum, some are cremated, and their cremains placed in a niche or variously in a garden. In this country, we're fortunate. We are able to go back to the cemeteries where our great-grandparents and great-great-grandparents are buried and be able to visit and think about their lives and to honor them. This is not true necessarily in other countries. Okay. Actually, it is not that unusual for families who lived in small villages in Europe to have intermarriage. Many, many times, as we go back through genealogy, we find that a couple are actually second or third degree cousins, in many cases first degree. Even though many people believe that marriages between first cousins should not or are not allowed to take place, this is not necessarily the truth. We have many examples in my family and my wife's family, which we've studied back many generations, where there are marriages of cousins of some degree. So here we have my parents getting married, who were already double third cousins. My father's uncle married my mother's aunt. And during the wedding, the minister stopped and said, "Now what goes on here? Now John Grow, you're marrying Eva Rahm, and I know her mother was a Grow." And there was an explanation, and the minister said, "That's fine, that's enough," and he went ahead and married them. So my sisters and I, whenever we sit down, we have a family reunion as brothers and sisters, and also as quadruple fourth cousins. Now, we will be going out on the grounds, and we'll be looking at some of the historic families. We'll be looking at some rather curious things. I've brought my divining rods, if you will, and we'll be discovering how we can use these. They are used by the cemetery staff all the time in the older part of the cemetery. One, before we leave, I just want to point out that there's a name over here, Kohler, or Kohler, and we will be talking about that gentleman's brothers and sister and parents when we get out on the grounds. The records of Clinton Grove have never recognized or reported either religion or race. So we only know that people have been buried here since at least 1855. There were Afro-American people buried here as early as 1870. We also know that there have been people with Asian background and Latino background buried here before the turn of the century. As far as religion, the bulk of the people are Christian, although there are some who belong to no church. Among the Christians, there's a predominance of Protestants, but there are also representatives of both Roman Catholicism and Orthodoxy of both Russian and Greek varieties. There are at least a couple folk who were Jewish, and we believe there are a number of folk who were Buddhist. Beyond that, we are not sure. As I say, our records never showed that. But this is a public cemetery open to all without restriction. Now, let us go into the oldest section where we will remember two of the people who were buried here in 1855. The earliest burial of a woman in Clinton Grove Cemetery that we have been able to determine is Maria Leininger. Maria was the second wife of George Leininger, who is buried also in this area. Maria's family is buried behind the camera. Her maiden name was Zahn, and her family were farmers up near North Avenue and 21 Mile Road. Maria was only a young bride of about a year and a half when she passed away. We do not have record of the cause of death, but I have always suspected it may have had something to do with a pregnancy that did not carry forward in the proper way. She died in May of 1855 and was buried here. The first young man to be buried in the cemetery that we can determine is to the back. His name was Daniel Dunham. His marker lies flat behind that large marker. And he was only 17 and a half years old. We honored him in a walk in 1987 when we were speaking about people who were born the year that Michigan became a state, 1837. Daniel Dunham, again, has no record showing the cause of death, but at 17 and a half, it could very well have been disease, or it might have been some kind of farm accident on the family farm. Now, these wands that I've been carrying are needed by the cemetery staff to locate available land on a family plot for a present-day burial. These work on a principle that where the Earth's crust has been cut into, that the magnetic force of the Earth's force field has been interrupted, and the cutting through the soil will be reflected in the crossing of the wands. Now, our daughter and son-in-law, who are both chemical engineers working for an oil company, say this is impossible. But the staff here uses it all the time to find out if there is an available spot on a family lot. After all, the families that bought these lots still have space available for present-day members in many cases. So what we do is to walk across, and of course here's Maria Leininger, and we know she's buried there. The wands crossed. It's a narrow grave, and on we go. Now this looks like it's all grass, but as we walk over, the wands cross again. I'll step 2 paces, and sure enough, it's about 2 feet wide, and therefore most likely to be a grave. And then we'll walk the other way. And the wands cross 3, 4, 5 paces and a little more, and they open, and we can be sure that, we can be quite sure that that was a grave of someone buried in the past. Now, there are times when these indicate other things. Sometimes we'll find a small area, a foot or two square, and that would be the location of a bush or a small tree that had been taken out. Now we're going to go over near the road and locate something that was discovered a few years ago when a group came through with me. Well, we found out it was 2 feet wide, but when it got to be 10 feet long, we knew we had something more than a grave. So the children following behind me will go along and will outline what we know now was the foundation of the home of Mr. Welts. Mr. Welts was the farmer who gave this land initially for the cemetery. In fact, if we look that way, we'll see the trees. And the trees line what used to be the driveway into Mr. Welts' home. So we'll go over and walk along the foundation of Mr. Welts' house.
Don't walk farther, just stay right there. Move up.
Okay. Now, 1, 2, 3, 4. Fill in the line. One more.
Okay.
We pretty well kept the shape, staying where you were.
Now, what do you think this was?
Barn.
Somebody said barn. That isn't a bad idea, but it's not right. Huh?
A building?
A building. I thought I heard somebody else say it. It's hard to hear, you know.
A church.
A house. This was a house. This is where Mr. Welts lived. This was his house. That was the driveway coming up. Here was the front of the house, probably the living room and dining room. This was probably the kitchen. And wherever the foundation of the house had been, that's where the magnetic force had been interrupted. Therefore, we can trace it. A few years ago, I had a group of men from church, and I was doing the same thing with them. And the last man in the group was prying out the rods, and he started walking, and he got out here on the road. He said, "What is this? It's 10 feet long and 2 feet wide." He said, "I don't think it's a grave." I said, "I don't think so either." So I took over and followed up. Not only can we figure out where the house was, I can tell you where the steps were that went to the basement. You can find them here. Right here. And that's the bottom. And so the stairs came down and went into the basement. So it might have, this probably was the only place that had a basement. It would have been the old vegetable cellar or fruit cellar, and they would have kept their fruits and vegetables cold through the summer, and they'd store things for the winter. After all, they didn't have refrigerators like we have. Okay, let's come back to the road. So, with the help of the students from Ojibwa School, we've outlined the foundation of Mr. Welts' home, and then I came and showed where the stairs would have gone down into the old cold cellar or vegetable cellar of the house that would have been right in this area. So this was a surprise to me as much as to others when we did this. We are so used to looking for graves, and here is part of the living history. The children who are visiting Clinton Grove this morning are students from the Ojibwa School of the Chippewa Valley School District. I wanted to point out to them that John W. Miller and his family are buried at this point. Mr. Miller was a farmer on Heidenreich Road, just across from Ojibwa School. Many of his family still live in the area, and we particularly remember him at our church, at Zion United Church of Christ, because he was one of the 6 original charter trustees, along with Mr. Rocker, Mr. Mirtham, Mr. Reimold, Mr. Rosso, and Mr. Devanchet. Now we'll go up to our humor corner. Some years ago, Bob Ripley, in his column, Believe It or Not, highlighted this corner of Clinton Grove Cemetery. We remember the family of Ebenezer Wright Hall and his wife, Mary Ann Beer. And of course, what does the family monument say? Beer Hall. This is the Beer Hall corner of the cemetery. Now, a further story, the granddaughter of Mr. and Mrs. Hall, we know of, and when she and her husband, who was the owner of a beer company in Cincinnati, were having their child, their first son, her mother said to her, well, you know, my dear, you really should use family names for your son. And I think your son's name should be Beer Hall Weideman. Well, he wasn't named that. Dr. Weideman lives in Saginaw. He may be known as Beer Hall to some of his friends, but his real name is Richard. When we were inside the mausoleum, I referred to Bill Kohler, or Kaler, and I said I'd tell the rest of the story when we got out here, and I always forget the hookup when we're in there. Julius Kaler was a good man, and he and his wife Pauline had a family of four children. There was Clara, and Bill, and Julius, and Paul. And when little Paul was born, Pauline was a farmer's wife, and after a couple weeks, she had to go back and help out in the barns and with the animals. Now, one of the things we have to remember and we think about differences between now and when some of these people lived. Today, we have St. Joe Hospital, Montgomery's General, other hospitals around if there's a need. We have doctors available. We have all kinds of medications and things to help us live long and be healthy. People in those days didn't have that. Babies were born at home, and the mother did the best she could, and sometimes some friend or relative would stop in, and she, after a couple weeks, she had to go back to taking care of house and doing things because life had to go on. And Mrs. Kohler was out in the barn feeding one of the horses, and he may have been a nice horse, and he may not have meant it at all, but he kind of nuzzled up against her, and she was still very weak from having had the baby, and she started to bleed and having a problem. And you can talk to your mothers or your grandmothers about that, because maybe your grandmothers remember when people were still, children were still born at home. And there was no hospital to go to, and the lady died. Well, Mr. Kohler did the best he could for his children. He married again, made sure the whole family went to church. And on Christmas Sunday in 1885, so that will be 110 years ago this Christmas, Clara was with her Sunday school group around the Christmas tree, and they were singing songs, and all of a sudden, Clara fell over, and she was dead. She had a disease called diphtheria. Diphtheria is one of the many diseases for which you had shots when you were a baby. And virtually no one has diphtheria anywhere in the world anymore. It's one of these diseases we have conquered. But not only did Clara die that Sunday night, but her two little brothers, Julius and Paul, died by the next morning, and all three were buried that afternoon here at the cemetery. Diphtheria was very serious. My mother's sister died of diphtheria. My mother had diphtheria, and they thought she would die, and it was a big tragedy. She lived to be, well, almost 88, 1 month short of 88, but it was something that a lot of children had. We are used to thinking of all of our friends growing up with us and being with us through school, through high school, maybe into adulthood. That wasn't true long ago. And you talk to your own grandparents and great-grandparents if you have them, and ask about your families, because these are stories that you should know about your families, and no one can tell them to you but your own family. And these are things you might want to tell them later to your children. And that's part of what you might learn from here, is the ability to remember and to learn about the past. And then maybe learning about the past, we can do something better for the future. When you buy medicine today, what color is the container? That's right, it's usually clear or something you can look through, either clear or kind of a yellow to protect against the sun's rays. But what color was medicine, what color was the containers that the medicine was put in a century, long, long ago? Green, blue, black? something dark, something you couldn't look through. Some of them were even white, but they were china and you couldn't look through. Well, Dr. Ebenezer Hall, who was a medical man, felt that it was important that his patients see the medicine that they're going to take, the powders or the pills or whatever it was that he was going to give them. So he started the idea that medicine bottles should be clear, and in those days they were made out of glass. In fact, he and his son-in-law started the Mount Clemens Glass Factory, which developed medicine bottles and made them for a long, long time. Now, we were just down on the corner talking about Ebenezer Wright Hall and his wife, Mary Ann Beer. This, Dr. Ebenezer Hall, was the father of Ebenezer Wright Hall and the grandfather of Columbus Hall, for whom Hall Road is named. I think all you children know where Hall Road is. It leads to Lakeside. All right, we'll go around the corner. One of the men that worked very closely with Henry Ford in the development of the automobile was Horace Rackham. Horace Rackham was born in Harrison Township, and at this location are buried his mother and father and others of the family. You'll notice the large family monument there with the flowers around it. At one point, Horace Rackham left money to Clinton Grove Cemetery so that every year there would be fresh flowers planted that would grow through the summer and fall in memory of his parents. Now we'll go down the road and remember a young man who died at the age of 37 way back in 1844, which of course means he was first buried somewhere else. And it's a very interesting story. So we'll go down there at this point. This marker for Henry P. Jenny has the longest inscription of any in the cemetery. Now, to paraphrase it, Henry P. Jenny died May 8, 1844 at the age of 37, or in his 37th year. The inscription says that he came to Michigan from his native Massachusetts, having already crossed the Atlantic repeatedly is the word, having visited the islands of the Pacific and having obviously traveled a great deal. And exactly, he arrived in Michigan on May 8, 1843, and 1 year later to the day, he drowned in a Lake St. Clair. A rather sad story. One of the problems that researchers have when they're doing historical research is that occasionally they come up with different versions, different legends about the same person. One of these people is someone we have honored here in Macomb County and in the Clinton Township, Mount Clemens area for a long time, Richard Connor. Richard Connor, according to one source, lived first in Maryland, served in the Revolutionary War in some capacity, and after the war, with his wife, whose name, according to that record, was one name, and according to another name, was a different person, moved to the area around Marietta, Ohio. We will be talking in a moment about the Tucker family. According to the one version that I have used, the Tuckers and the Connors were neighbors. The Tuckers had the general store, the Connors, Mr. Connor was the blacksmith. The Indians descended upon them about the year 1781 in the fall, abducted, captured the whole of the two families, brought them here to the banks of the Clinton River, and left them, as I always say to you kids, to die a horrible death. Well, they'd forgotten that Richard Connor had been a revolutionary soldier, and William Tucker had learned how to live and how to survive from the American Indians, the Native peoples, and the two families survived the winter. Now, the Connor family lived in the area for a long time, intermarried. The one son, Henry, married a local woman from the French community, and they are the ones for whom Connor Creek and Connor Avenue in Detroit are named. Richard Connor and his wife lived in Detroit. Mrs. Connor died there, and then Richard Connor moved out to live with his daughter, Susanna. Now, Susanna may have been a baby when the Indians brought them to the Clinton River, or maybe she was born the winter that they were here as prisoners. It's hard to know. But in any case, when she grew up, she married a man named Harrington. And we have Harrington Road over here with the Mount Clemens General Hospital on it. The Harrington family had its own cemetery until about 1870. And at that time, the descendants of Richard Connor and Susanna Harrington brought all the graves here and were reburied here in Clinton Grove. Now, another version of the story says that Richard Connor was not an American Revolutionary soldier, lived in Painesville, Ohio, and came here without knowing William Tucker. You do your own research and draw your own conclusions. But Richard Connor, no matter which story you believe, is still the person who died the longest ago, 1808, who was buried here in Clinton Grove. He was born in 1718, according to some people, in Ireland, according to others, in Maryland. Take your choice. Richard Connor is buried over here by this small footstone. It's not a headstone, it's a footstone. A little round one here, and the initials RC are on the other side. Come and visit, do your own research, and draw your own conclusions, and help us decide which of the versions might be the right one.
Do you watch
when
where
she was
you
born, Kelly?
I don't want
to
see
what
you
day
she was born.
Cool.
Now, our ancestors came to North America for all kinds of reasons. Some didn't even want to come, but they were brought anyway. Many of the people came for some kind of freedom. Religious freedom or political freedom. Many of the people who came 300, 400 years ago when we hear about the early history of this country. This represents a man or a group, this man was the leader of it, who came over only about 20 years ago because his country of Laos was under communist domination and he didn't, and his people wanted freedom. Not only that, but he was a Christian. He was a minister of his group and a leader of his area. So the adults will remember, because I think it was before the time that these young people were with us, hearing all the stories about the boat people. And Reverend Kuth was one of the leaders that helped the people get out of Laos. The ethnic group was called H-M-O-N-G, Hmong. And the Hmong people are Christian, which puts them in the minority in Buddhist Laos. And they came over and they established themselves initially in Michigan, and many have moved to other places. But when he passed away, they wanted a special place for him, and that's where it was. Now, many of the rest, they actually own a whole section of the cemetery for themselves. We're going to walk through, stay on the grass, just watch your feet so you don't trip on anything. And we'll go to another ledger stone that's another story of somebody who was looking for freedom in recent years. I mentioned that people have come to this country at various times looking for freedom. And you talk to your family, to your grandparents, to your great-grandparents if you haven't, and find out when your ancestors came to the United States, where they came from, and why they came. I'm sure there would be a story that someday you want to tell somebody else. Now, Mr. Tremanis and Mrs. Tremanis lived in a country that for many, many years was under Soviet domination. It's called Latvia.
It's a very small country on the Baltic Sea, and maybe you can look on a map when you get back to school. During the Second World War, Mr. Tremanis was in this army, and when the war ended, he found that he was in Norway. But he couldn't go back to Latvia because the Russians were there, the Soviet army was there, and he couldn't return. At the same time, his wife Vera escaped on a boat and went to Sweden. And she went looking for him, and he went looking for her. And it took many, many years. In the meantime, of course, he worked. He worked for the United Nations, he worked on laboring crews, he helped to build roads and helped to restore Europe after the war. But every time he had a chance, he'd go to Geneva, to the refugee center, and he'd talk to the director and said, "Do you have any word about my wife?" And every time the man would say, "I'm sorry, Mr. Primanis, I don't." And finally, the last time he was there, the fellow said, "I don't think we can do anything else. We've looked in every corner we could. We don't have any information about Vera." And so he left, and of course, it was very sad. And if I remember his telling me the story, he walked out of that office, he walked down into the main hall of the building, and he walked into his wife. She was just coming in to ask about him. So they got the right papers, they came to the United States, he worked for one of the auto companies for many years, they had no children, they had each other, and they had their various friends from Latvia. And when she died from cancer, he was very, very sad. And he said to me, "I want something special for my wife, something that will tell another Latvian that we were Latvian." So I went to a book I had when I was about your age that had flags and coats of arms of countries. And I found the one for Latvia. And then he brought in a pair of gloves that his wife had knitted. And on it was this symbol, which means the sun. And he says, "Anyone who's Latvian knows this because they use the same design." So we put that up. So this is their special memory. Mr. Tremanis is still alive. He's over 80 years old. And I once in a while have seen him. And he's not strong, but he comes quite often and remembers his wife, and that's what the cemetery is about, memory.
And when he dies, he's gonna...
Yes, his date will go on later. His cross, you see, is a what is called a Latin cross. He happens to be Protestant. And her cross is what is known as the Orthodox or Eastern cross. She belonged to the Latvian Orthodox Church, or Russian Orthodox Church.
Yeah.
Orthodox. There's Roman Catholicism, there's Orthodoxy. There are two major branches, and Protestantism.
Is that different from a St. Catherine's cross?
What?
Is that different?
I can't say. I know.
Get your foot off that grave.
It's usually called the Eastern Cross. I don't think it's supposed to be that.
Well, it all is Catholic direction. I think that one,
Catherine's cross.
What? Is that different? Well, actually, he bought two spaces. We're standing on his space. Except he intends to be cremated, and his cremains will be placed at the bottom of her grave.
Okay, so that
it was one of these things that just happened and worked out beautifully. That space where you're standing is of no use because of the tree roots. There couldn't be a burial there, but it's big enough for a cremation interment. Now, we started in the mausoleum, and we're right here is we're going to look at a personal mausoleum. We're going to have to see to it. You watch where you stand. I just want to show this to you. You might want to come back later and take a rubbing. Now, this is not a monument like others that stand up. This is called a ledger stone, and it's placed flat over the grave. Mrs. McKee, Mr. and Mrs. McKee were owners of the Monitor Leader years ago, our local newspaper, which is now the Macomb Daily. And she, when she died, she had things placed on her ledger stone that represented things that she enjoyed in life. Now, she is obviously a descendant of someone who fought in the American Revolution, because here's the emblem of the Daughters of the American Revolution. She loved her country. There's our flag. She probably loved either Florida or Hawaii with the palm tree. Probably liked to go up in the northern part of Michigan because of the pines and the bird. She liked to travel. There's the Taj Mahal from India, and other symbols of that statuary comes from Italy, and I'm not sure where the other one might have been from, water bearer, probably Greece. But these represent things that she enjoyed in life. So it also represents something attractive, and there may be something there you want to copy. Now, we can walk across. I don't think there are any markers of any kind right here. But do watch where you stand. I don't want you tripping like I did when I was three.
One of the other old legends of this area has to do with William Tucker and his brother Edward. William and Edward lived in an area in the colony of Virginia and were abducted by the Indians after the Indian raid which killed their parents, in which their parents died. William and Edward were brought back generally to this area, we don't know exactly where. But the story is that Edward died, drowned in the lake because he did not learn, as I put it, he did not pass his canoeing merit badge. He did not learn to canoe safely and died. William grew up. William was about your age. He was about 10, 12 years old. Edward was a little younger. And William grew up with the Indians, he learned their language, and one day he realized that they were talking about attacking the fort in Detroit. Now, we have to remember that when this area was settled, the first people who were here spoke French, and they were subjects of the King of France. And the village of Lance Cruz was a village in which French was the language, and the priest came out from Detroit twice a year to take care of the religious needs of the families. There was a war between France and England. England won, and the fort in Detroit became a British fort. We have to remember that this land that we're in now was part of the colony of Virginia. And so Richard Tucker, as a Virginian, was also very loyal in his allegiance to King George III of England. So we have to remember that even though we're in the United States now and Richard Connor may or may not have fought for the independence of the United States, I like to think he did, at the time that these people were born, they were British subjects. So when William Tucker heard that the Indians were going to attack the fort, he hurried away somehow, snuck away at night, ran through the forest, got to Detroit and warned the British. So when the Indians did attack, they were defeated. The story is that William Tucker was returned to his home near what is now Marietta, Ohio, had his general store. Then, in the same Indian raid in which Richard Connor and his family were abducted, he and his family also were brought back to the banks of the Clinton River. William Tucker's son and children lived in this area, and the Tucker Farm is now Selfridge Air Force Base. The Tuckers had their own cemetery for many years in what is now Harrison Township, and some of the family were brought and buried here in a ceremonial removal from the old cemetery. So, as we walk through Clinton Grove, you'll see the name Tucker, and you'll see the name Connor. And both of those names are descendants from the original people that we've talked about. Now we'll move over and talk about the third large family that's here, also descendants from one of the settlers, and those are the descendants of Christian Clemens, for which the village and the city of Mount Clemens were named. One of the other historic families in this area is that of Christian Clemens. Christian Clemens came as a member of the Army Corps of Engineers to lay out a road right-of-way between Detroit and what is now Port Huron. By this time, 1796, the Northwest Territories had been established by the United States of America, and he was working directly under the authority of the American Army Corps of Engineers. When he came to the point where the Clinton River bends through what is now the middle of Mount Clemens, he saw the high banks and he thought, this would be a wonderful place to have some government buildings. And when he came back 2 years later with his family, he laid out the original plat of the village of Mount Clemens. His daughters grew up in this area, and one of his daughters, Mrs. Dickinson, was the wife of Mount Clemens' first mayor. His great-granddaughter, the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Dickinson, then became the wife of Mr. Crocker, the next mayor, the mayor number two of Mount Clemens. Christian Clemens and his wife, Elizabeth, are not buried in Clinton Grove. They're buried in the original village cemetery, which is located in downtown Mount Clemens, where M3 turns to go north out of town. It's now generally considered a park. But if you look, you'll see the large monument that was placed there to memorialize the Clemens family. Now we'll go over and talk about Ludwig Wesolowski. This gentleman's name is Ludwig Wesolowski. Now, that's not an English name like some of the others that we've been talking about. What country do you think he came from? Poland? And you said Russia, and they're both right. Because when he was a boy, there was no Poland. It was where he lived in Warsaw that he was under the control of the Russian government. And they didn't like it because he was like a lot of students that we've heard of in recent years who were dissident students. He wanted to go out and do something, and he wanted very much to see the independence of Poland come back. And the Russians didn't like that. So they gave him a one-way ticket to New York City. And in New York, he met Sarah Fletcher, and they had their family. Ludwig Wesolowski was an engineer. So when the Clinton-Kalamazoo Canal was being planned, he was hired to be the general supervisor, the general engineer on the project. He came and they built the canal from the Clinton River up along what is now Canal Road. I'm sure some of you go shopping along Canal Road in Garfield. There's a big shopping center there. And it went up past Utica and got about as far as what is Yates Cider Mill today. Maybe you'll get there this fall during some of the nice weather and have some cider. But when you're at the cider mill, you can still see the end, a little bit, of the old canal. Now, the canal builders ran out of money. And while they were waiting, the young man, Mr. McGarvey, who was the assistant to Mr. Wesolowski, said, well, I think I'm going to leave here. There isn't much future here. I'm going across the river into Ontario, where they've just discovered oil. We have to remember that the first oil discovered in North America was over near Oil Springs, near Oil City and Petroleum. So Mr. McGarvey went over, and sure enough, he discovered oil, and he had his oil claims. And then he came back, and he knocked on Mr. Wesolowski's door, and he said, how would it be if I marry your daughter, Helen? I've got all this money and I can take care of her. And Mr. Wesolowski and Mrs. Wesolowski thought it was a very good idea. So Helen Wesolowski married Mr. McGarvey. They went over to Oil Springs, Ontario. Mrs. McGarvey got all her husband's oil claims as a wedding gift, and she became the richest woman in the world. In fact, she's the first woman to have $1 million all to herself. She didn't have to depend on her husband for that. Well, they took their money and they went back to Europe and they built a beautiful villa overlooking the Adriatic Sea. And they had one little girl named Mimi Helen, who grew up, went to the right schools, learned to sew and to sing and to play the piano, came out through all the best parties, and she got married to a man named Count von Zeppelin. Ever heard of the word Zeppelin? Well, it's the same as a blimp. Count von Zeppelin was very interested in lighter than aircraft. The only problem with their marriage was that Count von Zeppelin was 40 years older than his wife. So, not surprisingly, that marriage didn't last terribly long. And Mimi Helen McGarvey, the Countess von Zeppelin, went to live in one of the castles. And where was that castle? She lived out her life there until about 1940, in Poland, from which her grandfather had been thrown out as a dissident student. So here's the story from what once was Poland through, and at that time Russia, through Michigan, Mount Clemens, Clinton Township, over to Oil Springs, Ontario, back to Europe, and back to Poland. It's just one of the curious stories, one of the places that Mount Clemens and Clinton Township have played in the life of the world. Now, we'll move over and see some other things. There are many wonderful and curious stories that are associated with folks buried here in Clinton Grove, who represented the life and times of Clinton Township in the village of Mount Clemens and then the city of Mount Clemens back all the way to 1855. At one point, one of the gentlemen left his property in downtown Mount Clemens to the cemetery, although he said the cemetery could not sell it for 99 years. Now that property happened to be a bar. So not only did Clinton Grove have a beer hall corner, but it also had a bar downtown. Well, that property has been sold and the money turned to good use here at the cemetery. This is a personal mausoleum. It belongs to the Trufant family or their descendants. One of the descendants was an attorney for whom my wife worked, Bert V. Nunley. And at one point, we were asked to take care of the personal mausoleum, so occasionally we come and we sweep out the leaves and make sure everything is fine. This is very much like the mausoleum we were in at the first, only in this case, it is only for one family. Now, you may step inside and see that there's nothing unusual. You'll see the engravings for the family that are entombed here. The Trufants were a lumbering family. They came to Michigan from New York State in the 1845 and lived up in the Romeo area. Then later on, the Trufants moved to a town near Big Rapids, and it's there today. It's called Trufant, Michigan. The one daughter was Mrs. Nunley, and she and her husband had the farm down near where Nunley Road, Metropolitan Beach Highway, and Gratiot Cross. The son had a farm also, the Trufant Farm in Clinton Township. So take a look, and then we'll go on and read, we'll go on then to the story of the brothers and family rivalry. Now, do you children know anybody that if they get something new, their brother or sister also has to get something new? Or if they go out to McDonald's, their brothers and sisters also have to go out and get something to eat? Well, I think you do, and I think you know there are people in your own families. And here we have a family that's just the same way from a long time ago. Just because this gentleman, Charlie Ulrich, passed away, and his wife Margaret decided to honor his memory by putting up a large obelisk, his brother, or more likely his sister-in-law, when his brother died, put up a bigger obelisk. So we have Charles Ulrich and his brother Paul. Charles' wife Margaret was a sister to Matilda Miller Ulrich. Oh, by the way, these girls were daughters of the farmer, Mr. Miller, that we talked about way up front. So we have two brothers having rivalry and two sisters having rivalry. But Charlie, who doesn't have the biggest monument, maybe he got even somehow because mother's buried with him. That's just a silly kind of story. By the way, Clinton Grove is a traditional monument cemetery, which you realize by now. And people can have the monument of their choice in many ways by checking through the front office and making the proper arrangements. Now we have a story that goes back to the Bath era of Mount Clemens. Dorr Kellogg was a man who had a mill here in Mount Clemens. He would receive the grain that farmers would bring to him and grind it up, and the farmers would take it away as flour. Now, one time, an old farmer who came from the French community of Lance Cruz out in Harrison Township came in, and he said, "Well, Jacques, how are you?" And old Jacques said, "Oh, I'm all right, but this old horse of mine, it's so old, I think I'm going to have to kill it." And Mr. Kellogg said, "Well, he's been a good friend to you all these years. Why not just let him stay here? I've got that water tank, and there's always a little bit of water dripping out of it. There's a little pool there, and the grass is nice and green. Let your horse stay here, and don't worry about him. When the time comes, the horse will die." Well, months went by. Another time, old Jacques came back with some more grain and a new horse. And he said, "Well, I see my old horse is gone. It must have died." "Oh, no, no, he's standing right there under the water tank." "Oh, that can't be my horse." "Oh, it is your horse. He sits there, stands there all day. He eats grass, he drinks from the pond, and he does look good, doesn't he?" "Well," he said, "why don't you take your old horse, take him home with you now. He's in pretty good health." So Dorr was thinking about things, and he had had a little problem with his skin. So he thought, maybe there's something in that water. So he washed his skin in that water that came out of the mineral, out of the tank. And sure enough, he got rid of the blemishes he had. Well, about that time, Dr. Abram Hayward came down from Romeo. He was in town on business, and he went over to Dr. Abner Hayward. And Dr. Hayward stopped in to see Mr. Kellogg and take home some flour to his wife. And Mr. Kellogg told him the long story. "And do you think, Doc, do you think there's anything good in this water?" And Dr. Hayward said, "Most likely. A lot of mineral water is very healthy." He said, "I'll tell you what. I've got a lady up in Romeo, Mrs. Tedman. She has the millinery store. She makes hats for women. And she has arthritis, something awful. Why don't you make me a tub? I'll tell you how big to make it. When you have it done, you let me know. And we'll bring Mrs. Tedman down, and we'll let her take some baths in this mineral water that you have here." And sure enough, that happened, and Mrs. Tedman felt a lot better. So Dr. Hayward went back to his home, and he said to his wife, Alice, who also became a doctor, "You know, I think we should move to Mount Clemens." So that's what they did. They built a building down in the middle of town. They had rooms for people to stay there, and people would come and take their baths. And that's how the bath industry got started here in Mount Clemens. Now, the bath industry went on, and there were many hotels. Some of the hotel owners are buried in this cemetery. Some of the entertainers are buried in this cemetery. There's Howard Miller, who was a magician. and there are some others. And when we get over to the next stop, we'll introduce you to one of the most famous entertainers that was here in Mount Clemens. Remember, Mount Clemens in the 1890s had all the entertainment and all the things going on in it that we hear about nowadays in Las Vegas. It was the entertainment and health center for this part of America. Now we'll go on to another story. We've talked about some of the early residents of the area, the folks who lived near the Clinton River and Lake St. Clair who had a French background. We've mentioned the Tucker family and the Connor family. And this is another early group that we're memorializing here, the Moravian Mission Group. The Moravian Church developed as a Protestant church in an area that is now known as the Czech Republic in Europe. Their missionaries came and established Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, and went on to be missionaries to American Indian tribes in different places. One of the leaders, David Seisberger, worked with the Delaware Indians in what is now Ohio. At the time of the American Revolution, the Moravians and their Indian students chose not to take sides. And as a result, neither the American patriots nor the British defenders cared for them. David Seisberger and many of his group were arrested and brought to Detroit for trial before the British general, before the British commander. The commander found no fault in them and allowed them to settle in peace under his protection. They built a little village at the point where Moravian Road crosses Clinton River, and they built a number of houses for themselves. For business, they made furniture, which they took to Detroit to sell. The road they built, which is basically along what is now Moravian Drive and Shaner, and then down into Detroit along what is now Gratiot, was the first free road from this area into Detroit. They stayed in this area from 1781 to 1786, when the British realized they really did have to move across the river to Canada to stay under British control, because this area was now part of the United States of America and part of the Northwest Territories. The descendants of the Moravians still live in an area known as Moravian Town, about 70 miles east of here, near the village of Thamesville, Ontario. There is a museum, and there is a reconstruction of at least two of their buildings. Anyone who is interested can make the ride over there very easily, right along Highway 2, east of Thamesville. Now, children, look around and see if there's a name you see that you recognize from something maybe you saw on television. Okay, you all recognize the name Kibble. Kibbles and Bits, I can hear you all calling it. Well, did you know Mr. Kibble was a real man? He's buried right here. He lived here in Mount Clemens during the days that the mineral baths were very popular. He was the stage manager for the Opera House. Now, he had his own animal act. He had dogs, and he took his dogs all over the country to perform their acts for circuses and for shows. In fact, he had his own train. Now, when he'd be traveling with his animals on the train, The dogs had to eat at the time that they were supposed to, and it didn't matter whether the train was running or stopped. So he had to take food with him for the dogs to eat on the trips. So before he'd take a trip, he'd go over to Charlie Elric's meat market and he'd buy some nice tenderloin and he'd take it and he'd cut it into long strips. And then he'd take the long strips and put it in the oven and bake it just enough that it was dry. And then he would carry these long strips or long thongs of meat in the train. And when it was time for the animals to eat, he'd get it out and he'd chop it up into little bits. And people would say, "What are you doing, Bill Kibble?" "Well, I'm kibbling." "Well, what are you kibbling, Bill Kibble?" "I'm kibbling my bits." And that's where it all started. Now, Mr. and Mrs. Kibble had a son, William, who went through Mount Clemens High, and just by coincidence happened to be in the same class as my brother-in-law. As far as we know, Mr. Kibble is living and is very well and is very happy with his kibbles and bits. Now, this is the end of our tour today. There are so many other stories that could be told, some of them rather poignant, some of them with a meaning, a point to them. But we don't have any more time. So this is the time that your teachers will take you and do the rest of your trip, which is to make some rubbings that you can take back to school and use for your classwork. If anyone has any further information, any questions or want further information, I would just say they should stop at the main office up in the front of the cemetery and the staff there can help them. And please, when the time comes, join the staff on one of the annual cemetery walks and find out something new and different for yourselves. Thank you. I'd like to thank the audience for watching today. This has been enjoyable for me. I want to thank Pat DeWandler from the Clinton Township Historical Society, Clinton Moravian, and also John Brooks for patiently guiding me through this telecast. Thank you to all and best wishes. Good day.
Wasn't that interesting? We'd like to thank Dr. Grove for his time and hope that you join us for our next episode of The History Show. This is Pat DeWandler for Channel 5.